There's a legend that comes from the bluesmen of the Mississippi Delta. If you want to play your guitar really well, there is a way, if you dare. You must take it to a crossroads at midnight. A tall, dark man will approach you. Don't be afraid. Hand him your instrument and let him tune it. When he gives it back to you, you'll find that you can make your guitar sing and cry. But beware, that man is the devil. And the price of playing the guitar that well is your soul. The story goes that that's what happened to a blues guitarist called Robert Johnson at a crossroads just outside of Clarksdale, Mississippi. In a way, it doesn't matter whether it's true or not. The myth has stuck. Johnson played brilliantly, recorded very little, lived fast and died young. That was enough to make him a guitar hero when the blues were rediscovered by a new generation of rock guitarists in the 60s. Many came here as pilgrims to Clarksdale to see the crossroads for themselves. But by then, the instrument itself had been transformed, made its own pact with the devil when the guitar turned electric. Seventy years after Robert Johnson's death, look what the guitar has become. An icon of popular culture, a fashion accessory, shop window shorthand for a flirtation with rebellion and sexuality. And maybe people sensed its potential long ago.
The name of my ailment was Longin, and it was not cured till I finally went to the department store and counted out the money in small coins before the dismayed clerk. A moment later, the shining instrument under my arm, I could scarcely wait till I reached home to break the news to my father and mother. I knew how the other youngsters would gather around, and I had no doubt that I would be able to entertain the girls royally.
The man who wrote that was W.C. Handy, known as the father of the blues. Unfortunately, when he got it home, his father ordered him to take the sinful thing back and buy a dictionary instead. But there is something here I wanted to see, something that in retrospect now seems very significant. This place is a shrine, and this unprepossessing object is the Holy of Holies. It's affectionately known as the frying pan, and it transformed the story of modern music. This is the very first electric guitar. Believe it or not, the first electric guitar wasn't designed to play blues or jazz, but this, Hawaiian music, an exotic sound that was all the rage around the world in the early 20th century. The trademark Hawaiian sound was achieved by sliding a metal bar known as a steel up and down the strings of a guitar laid flat across the lap. Thank you.
flying guitar went around the world. It was the first world music craze. It was the first guitar craze. It was a sound nobody had ever heard before. One day in the 1880s, a fellow named Joseph Keikuku reportedly was walking down the railroad tracks with his guitar on his back, and he found a railroad spike, slid it along the strings, and the light bulb went on. And he hid out with it for about 7 years, working on it, and unleashed it on the world. By 1904, he was playing in front of the King and Queen of England. By 1916, more Hawaiian records were selling in America than any other kind of records. It became this exotic novelty. There were kind of sexual connotations of, you know, the white guy having an experience with a native girl, and it's all very romantic in an era where people didn't travel very far from their home usually. And so by the 1920s, every middle-sized town in America had a quote-unquote Hawaiian band playing in the local restaurants.
It was absolutely extraordinary. It was so popular that you would have cowboy bands, which basically is bands of ordinary people wearing cowboy clothes, so they look like cowboys. And they would play as, say, for example, the Barn Dance Troubadours on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. And then they would change their outfits and put on their colorful shirts, and they would play as the Waikiki Troubadours on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And so you had the same instrumentation both times, and that is how the pedal steel guitar became such a staple of country music.
It really was the first time that the guitar was a featured instrument. Remember, in the typical dance orchestra of the day, the banjo was the rhythm instrument, and the guitar was only just coming in as a rhythm instrument. But in the 20s, the only soloists were the lap players.
But it wasn't the first time that this haunting sound had been heard in America. It was also to be found in the less than exotic Mississippi Delta, a guitar style known as blues bottleneck.
The age-old question of which came first, Hawaiian slide guitar or blues bottleneck guitar, is an unanswered question. For one, I think if you take a human being, a string, and a hard object, eventually they're going to seek to imitate the voice.
In 1903, W.C. Handy, the same young man who'd suffered so acutely from guitar lust as a boy, had another momentous encounter with the instrument. He fell asleep at the station in the backwater town of Tutwiler, Mississippi, while waiting for a train. According to Handy, he was woken by an unearthly sound.
A lean, loose-jointed Negro had commenced plunking a guitar beside me while I slept. His clothes were rags. His face had on it some of the sadness of the ages. As he played, he pressed a knife on the strings of the guitar. It was the weirdest music I had ever heard.
It became one of the most influential and expressive forms of self-accompaniment with the guitar in what we call the blues.
Yeah, slide really does make you feel that way, because it's such a terrific thing. And sometimes it really is transcendental music. Been a while since I did that.
I play the blues, you know, bring the sad feeling, you know, like when you're downhearted and you can sing about it, how you come, how hard you came up, or how hard you worked and all that kind of stuff like that. That's somebody down, you know. That's what the blues will really make you think about. But
got me running, you got me hiding.
playing the blues, you know, what down hard, having a hard time or whatever, you know, I say, just get those sad blues, you know, kind of helps you out.
The fact is that guitar blues was never a popular style, and guitar players were so poor that the guitar was described as the starvation box. It was the outsider's instrument long before it became cool. Many of the early blues guitarists were blind and had no other means of earning a living on the road. It's hard for us to imagine today because blues guitar has become part of the bedrock of popular music. But in the 20s and 30s, it had no significant commercial influence on the evolution of the guitar. That was all happening in the Hawaiian bands. And it was here that trouble was brewing, as the guitar simply wasn't loud enough.
Because the guitar is not naturally a very loud instrument, and in any case, they were playing, the featured guy, you know, the guy who was playing the solos, was playing it like this, so the sound was going up into the rafters. That was the beginning of the efforts to amplify the guitar.
And it was all thanks to a laptop player named George Beecham, who teamed up with a Slovak violin maker called John De Piera, who had an ingenious idea using not wood, but metal.
You'll see inside there are three cones in here. This guitar resonating cone was invented the same year as the loudspeaker, and they look very similar. It's a conical thing with a crimped edge so it can bounce up and down. These things basically amplify mechanically and project the sound. It's Victrola technology, it's not electrical. And the volume on this is absolutely incredible. I had the fortune of knowing Mr. De Piera before his death, and one of the questions I asked him is, well, what did you think the first day when you first strung up the first one you made? And I never forget what he said. He said, I went home to my wife and I said, Jesus, we got a hell of a something here.
But it wasn't enough for George Beecham, who moved on to a hell of a something else. And the key was electricity.
You're crazy!
Crazy, am I? We'll see whether I'm crazy or not.
Tinkering with electronics had become as American as apple pie and singing cowboys. Beecham was relying on a basic electrical principle to amplify the sound of the guitar's strings. That metal lump on this wooden prototype is called a pickup, and it's essentially a horseshoe magnet wrapped in a coil of wire. When the string is plucked, its vibration creates a disturbance in the magnetic field, which produces an electrical signal. It's this which was then amplified to take its place on the typical American bandstand. Blink and you've missed it. But this is the earliest known footage of Beecham's electric guitar in action.
By playing around with you.
Here's a 1930s Rickenbacker frying pan. You can see why they might have called it the frying pan. It's a cast aluminum neck and body as one unit. The strings are raised for Hawaiian-style playing, and of course, without plugging it in, not much volume there.
From this moment on, the electric guitar would be tethered to and absolutely dependent upon its mate, the amplifier. The instrument had changed forever.
So one can debate whether biological evolution took place or whether it happened as it did in the Bible, but I don't think anybody's going to debate that this is the first model electric guitar, and from this arose all those others.
At the very same time, a boy from Wisconsin was obsessing about how to get more volume from his guitar.